Next up is this organization called Roobaroo. They're going to do a 15-minute presentation for you quickly. Roobaroo actually was born here last year, I would say. So I'm going to actually invite Ishita and Lisha from Roobaroo to do their presentation. The topic is going to be on relevance of discourse on sex and gender for prevention of abuse. Lisha is a child counselor. She used to first work with Hamara Footpath and now is a co-founder and counselor at Roobaroo. And Ishita Manik, a former bartender, part-time travel coordinator, full-time social worker, and a few other things. She was present at ASCCSA 2014, sitting in the audience as a simple layperson who had no social service-related background. Today, as the co-founder of Roobaroo, she speaks as someone who feels that anyone sensitized can make a difference. Welcome, Ishita.
As someone truly said, it's really intimidating to be here. I know I'm standing in front of a gathering of very experienced people, so a small disclaimer. Please hear me out as a simple layperson today, someone with no background in social work, maybe now a little bit, but no real background in social work or counseling or any such related topic. Early last year, I joined Hamara Footpath, which is an NGO that works with slum children. I joined them as a volunteer, and in the process of attending the classes, I happened to ask the founder, who's Taha, that had we done any safety programs for our children? I had no idea about safety programs before that. I don't even know how I came up with the word, but I did. And he said, yes, we had done a program, but that was years ago. And he also went on to add that there was this conference happening about a week or two later, which was related to the subject of child sexual abuse, and that is how I happened to attend the annual stakeholders conference 2015, being a layperson. So when I sat in the audience last year, and someone on the mic said, I don't remember who, I don't remember all the speakers, and someone went on to say that 53% of India's children are sexually abused. And I happened to think to myself that, you know, I'm one of those children. I wanted to start my story by saying I'm a survivor, but I've never really liked the word survivor, so I thank you for giving me the word thriver. So I'm going to say I'm a thriver. I was sexually abused by a family member growing up, and it's really hard to say this, but the abuse eventually led to rape at around 10. At the same time, a family friend's daughter happened to notice that something was amiss, and she brought it to my mother's notice. My mother sat me down and started questioning me. And as terrified as I was of being questioned, I told her exactly what was happening. And my mother's response was, you know, just shut up. Don't tell anyone because your dad's going to be really mad. And thanks to that, the abuse continued late into my teens. And not just me, my cousins, neighbors' children, children in the society, and even maids happened to undergo abuse at the hands of the same person. So the point being that everyone in the family knew. All of the adults eventually got to know. And I'm talking at a young age itself. Grandparents, uncles, parents, everyone knew about it and no one did anything. However, even at that young age, I knew that had somebody told me that what was happening with me was wrong, I know that I would have found the courage to put an end to it. Had I been empowered, I would have been able to put a stop to it myself, being a child. So growing up, in the corner of my head, I nurtured this notion. And I told myself that I'm going to do something about this. I'm not going to sit quietly like they did. And at 21, I confronted my family. For me, that was my moment of freedom. And there's never been any looking back from there. It further reinforced this thing in me that I wanted to do something about this. And that's how I happened to attend the annual stakeholders conference in 2014. All through my life, I have always taken my abuse and any kind of emotional charges related to my abuse to propel me. I use it as rocket fuel to put me in a positive direction. So sitting in the audience last year, I thought to myself, okay, you know, what I'm really good at is making a Long Island iced tea. What am I going to do? How am I going to do that something that I've been wanting to do for all these years? And this is where I want to thank the foundation. Because the foundation is a platform that gives you that thing that you need to do something about it. So a huge thanks to the foundation. You guys were the spark behind Roobaroo. And Roobaroo was born in this very auditorium on one of those chairs behind. Last year's session put me in touch with Arpan. And we approached them to undergo the Training of Trainers program with them. And they did way more than that. I mean, they opened their doors, their windows, their drawers, their files, their folders, and gave us whatever it is that we needed to move forward. As someone who has absolutely no social background related anything, someone who's not a counselor or therapist or an educationist, somebody who had never worked with children, they actually prepared us to go out and do what we needed to do. So Pooja and your team, Arpan, I know you guys are here. A big thank you to you guys. So today, I'm sure there are some people in the audience, or at least I hope there are some people in the audience who are here as solo attendees, who are not associated with any NGO or organization, don't have counseling experience, are not teachers, educators, lawyers, doctors, or anyone working in the field of CSA or children. And I say to you that you don't require any of that. You don't really need all that experience and qualifications to want to do something. I'm a bartender. I didn't know the technicalities. I didn't know the details of the matter. But yet, if I could, so can you. How many of you all have heard the starfish story? Can you raise your hands? So some people have and some people haven't. So I'm just going to say it quickly. There was a man who was walking along the seashore and he saw thousands of starfish washed up on the shore. And he began to pick them up one by one and flung them back into the sea. And another man who was passing by stopped and told him, you know, there are thousands of them, like what difference is it going to make? And this man said, well, to that one starfish, it made a difference. So to that one child, it's going to make a difference. You don't have to be an established NGO. You don't require massive funding. We still don't have the numbers to go up in front of funders and say like, hey, we approached so many hundred kids. Our numbers are very small compared to some established organizations. But our belief is that we reached out and we made a difference. And all you really need to make a difference is the will and the want to make that difference. Moving on to Roobaroo, when I decided to start this project, I received immense support from Taha, that's the previous organization that was working at Hamara Footpath, the founder Taha. He really provided us immense support along with Arpan, and our team came together. And our team now consists of Leisha, who's a co-founder. She's also a child counselor. Saloni, who's a senior counselor, our senior most counselor rather. And Paresh, who is our technical expert because we're pretty technologically challenged. So this is our team, and before I call upon my colleague to join me on stage and take over from here, I leave you with a very simple address, a simple ending address. On the last day of school, when I was filling up, you know, we have slam books or memory books where friends kind of write something on the last day of school. I wrote a line in all of my friends' books, and little did I know that what I wrote in 10th standard would mean so much to me today. And what I wrote was, dare to do what you believe in, but more importantly, believe in what you do. So believe that you can make a difference, believe that you can make change happen, and that's all you require for it to happen. Okay, so can I call Leisha? Come on.
Thank you, Ashita. So here we were with, you know, firm in our belief that we did want to make a change, supported by our amazing team. And we started going into the communities that we were associated with as Hamara Footpath and conducting personal safety education programs. We went to a couple of orphanages as well. But while conducting these programs, we felt like something was amiss. We felt like there were some bridges, there were some gaps in the curriculum that we wanted to bridge. So a forensic psychologist called Valerie Heller said, when she was talking about CSA, she said that we need to recognize that this is a form of social conditioning in our society. When we're talking about the kind of numbers and percentages that we're talking about, this isn't an abnorm, it is a norm. One in every two children is a norm in our country. And that is just heartbreaking. These numbers should not be acceptable. And it is a norm somewhere, because somewhere we have stood by and as a society let it happen. We've been silent about the issue. And we were approached by some parents and a couple of teachers as well to conduct personal safety education programs for their kids. And what they told us is, along with this, can you conduct, can you teach them about sex, sexual health, gender as well? And, just talk to them about it. And we were like, sure, we'd be happy to help. But why don't we instead train you all to talk to your children about it? And that would probably create a greater impact, you know. So they were like, no, we can't do this. And I was like, we were like, why can't you all do it? And the only thing they kept saying is that, no, it's uncomfortable, it's awkward, we're not professionals, y'all are professionals, y'all can talk to them. But our question to them was, and to ourselves actually, was that tomorrow if a child has a doubt, a concern, has something that they need to talk about, they're not going to be able to reach out to us, but they can reach out to that parent or that teacher who is in constant touch with them. And should they need that help, those people will be better equipped to provide that help to them. Not only that, if as parents, as teachers, we broach the subject of sex and sexuality in an open and honest way with our children, it would make it so much easier for them to come and talk to us about it. And that is something we wanted to incorporate into our program, you know, to talk about sex, to talk about sexuality, sexual health and safety and consent. While training at ARPAN, one of the things that I had a very interesting experience. One of our colleagues in our class asked me a question, and he was like, what is your gender? And I instantly replied, my gender is a female. And he's like, no, a female is your sex. What is your gender? And for me, that got me thinking, did I just put myself in a box? Did I just call myself a female? Do I only think of myself as a female, or am I a person? And gender is a social norm. It is a social construct that is in place for society to function smoothly. But when converted into stereotypes, it can be really debilitating. We tend to put people in boxes. We all know, we're all familiar with the fact that it is our stereotypes that make it difficult for a boy that is possibly the reason that a boy cannot report abuse. It is the reason when a female has been sexually abused, she, you know, her family honor comes into question. It is these stereotypes that make it difficult for us to surpass the problems that come with sexual abuse. And this is what we as Roobaroo want to incorporate into our personal safety education programs. We want to include sex education. We want to talk about sex, and we want to talk about gender. We want to take a three-pronged approach to this. We want to talk to children, of course, about it. We want to talk to abusers or potential abusers and create a dialogue with them as well, because we feel like there is not enough being done to reach out to them in terms of prevention. And lastly, we would want to talk to society, adults, because the responsibility of protecting our children falls squarely on our shoulders. So, yeah, that is, and for this, we want to thank the foundation again, because they're the ones who got us on this path of empowering people and, you know, looking to make a positive change. So, thank you.